You can see on the left side of this coat was dominated by the actual product of silk. Silk was one of the most important products on the Silk Roads, the long distance trade routes that went from China all the way through Central Asia and reached into Europe. As a matter of fact, this painting of women making silk was a painting done on silk, just to demonstrate the importance of silk in the Silk Roads trade network. In the middle picture, you see an example or an image of the Indian Ocean Trade Network. Dhows such as this were used to carry more, not only luxury items, but also bulk items in order because they were able to carry much higher weights. And they were able to carry them along much longer distances. On the right side, you see one of the most famous products traded on the Trans-Saharan trade. You see gold. Some of the most prominent products traded on the Trans-Saharan trade network were salt for gold, two of the most important things somebody could have in the year 1200 to 1450. One, extraordinarily useful, and the other, a mere luxury item that demonstrated the great wealth. Let's start with the Silk Roads. You can see in this map the Silk Roads that reach all the way from the Chinese shores, all the way across South Asia into Western Europe, and even touching into the Arabian Peninsula and into Africa. The Silk Roads existed long before the year 1200. As a matter of fact, the Silk Roads trace back maybe even to about 1,000 years before the year 1200, where silk was a prominent product in high demand in places across Central Asia, but especially in, at the time, the Roman Empire. The Silk Road was able to be such an important trade route because of the security of strong governments. Most famously, in the 1200s, the Mongol Empire developed enough strength to have a large enough empire to cover almost the entirety of the Silk Roads, making it the most secure time in the history of the Silk Roads and increasing the prosperity of merchants and states involved with Silk Road trade. But there were other innovative practices that helped to develop the Silk Roads as well. One important innovative practice was the idea of the caravanserai. Caravanserai is very similar to what we think of as hotel stops, the opportunity for people to stop and spend the night and maybe take care of their animals, have a meal, maybe have some entertainment. Caravanserai were an important reality of increasing trade along the Silk Roads. Another important innovative practice happened after the year 1200, during the Tang and Song dynasties. This was the idea in the introduction of paper money, or concepts of bills of exchange, opportunity with written certificate that said this is worth so much, and people believed it because of the weight of the name that was on it, or because of by a successful government. These innovative practices help promote growth along the Silk Roads. One of the most important realities of the Silk Roads is that trade builds cities. I know that felt a little bit dramatic, but I want it to feel dramatic because it's one of the most important realities of long-distance trade. Long distance trade is dependent on the existence of cities, but also cities and even states can grow to massive amounts as a result of long distance trade. One of the biggest ways that cities and states can become more powerful is by using the ability to tax, not only tax merchant activity, but the other economic activity that comes along when hundreds of merchants stop in one place and spend time trading their wares. There's two major examples of trade building cities along the Silk Roads. This is an example in China of a city called Kashgar. And down here we have an example just read about, Samarkand in Central Asia, result of trade on the Silk Roads. The Indian Ocean Trade Network was another very important trade network that existed in the time between 1200 and 1450. The Indian Ocean trade network also existed long before the year 1200, although not quite as long as the Silk Roads. The Indian Ocean trade network covered vast amounts of territory and was only successful because of people's ability to master monsoon winds. Monsoon winds were seasonal, often went in that went one direction for the next season. And it was merchants and maritime technicians' ability to master these winds and use them to plan out when and where they would be able to go that made trade in the Indian Ocean network possible. Other maritime technologies that were incredibly important to the development of the Indian Ocean trade network. In the top left-hand corner, you see a picture of a Chinese compass. And on the right side, you see an astrolabe. Both of these were incredibly important devices when it came to navigation. The astrolabe helped use the stars in order to navigate paths and routes to get to destinations. And the compass helped make sure that the ship was traveling in the right direction. There were also a number of shipbuilding technologies that led to faster and bigger ships over time in the Indian Ocean trade network. But one of the most important ship technology was the development of the triangular sail, known as the lateen sail, which helped make it possible for ships to move more quickly, and like previously mentioned, make it possible for them to master the monsoon winds. The Indian Ocean trade network also helped build new cities. One of the most important examples of this was the Swahili city-states. Swahili city-states existed in Africa on the eastern coast. You can see my laser pointer right now pointing directly at the Swahili cities. Syncretism, as many places there were developed from Eastern African tradition mixed with Arabic traditions because so many merchants came from that region. But they're also an example of states that grew because of their ability to master trade and tax trade in the region. Another important is the Sultanate of Malacca. The Sultanate of Malacca was built here. And again, it was also dependent on its ability to tax the merchant activities, especially in its ability to create a navy and stop ships in the water as they were going through the Strait of Malacca here. It's important to note that this is called the Sultanate of Malacca because it is a Muslim state that was created here. And that's a really important reality for us to understand. As merchants moved to new places, oftentimes they stayed in those places for long periods of time and developed their own communities there. These minority communities of people who were far away from their homeland is often called diaspora or diasporic communities. One of the most common examples used in the Indian Ocean is the example of Muslim merchant diaspora communities. But there are also many Chinese people who left China and developed new communities in Southeast Asia. And there are other examples of diasporic communities in the Indian Ocean trade network as well. Finally, today, we're going to take some time to talk about the Trans-Saharan Trade Network. The Trans-Saharan Trade Network was a trade network that went across the desert of North Africa and engaged in trade just below the Sahara Desert. Or I should say just south of the Sahara Desert, not just below, because that would involve some sort of mole people. So just south of the Sahara Desert. And like the other trade networks that we've learned about today, one of the most important realities of the Trans-Saharan trade network was that it helped to lead to the growth of new states. And that through the growth of those new states often harnessed trade and were able to take control of trade in those regions. The two most common goods traded on the Trans-Sahara trade network were salt from gold, but also commonly traded on the Trans-Sahara trade network were slaves traded mostly to Islamic empires to the east. So super important transportation technologies. There were also some super important transportation technologies that made the Trans-Saharan Trade Network more suitable. One of the most significant ones was the invention of a saddle that could be used to harness the ability of camels. Camels were much more able than horses or donkeys or other kinds of animals that were used on the Silk Road. Camels were much more capable of traveling through the desert of North Africa. And so caravans, such as the one you see on the screen here, were created using the saddle of the caravans, of the saddle to harness the camels, both to help carry the luxury items that were traded along the Trans-Saharan Trade Network, and sometimes to carry the merchants themselves. Okay, so we had a very short lesson today to discuss some of the key aspects of long-distance trade routes between 1200 and 1450. If there's more, that I strongly advise that you take the opportunity to go back and look at more information about these important trade networks. One of the reasons trade networks are so important in AP World History is because trade networks provide the connectivity that brings people from one region to another and helps to lead to greater interconnectedness of our world and the constant process of globalization that brings about change and major events in world history. So take the extra time that you have today to go and maybe use Wikipedia or your textbook or the AMSCO book and learn more about these three important trade networks.